Audio presents Ratburger, written by David Walliams, read by David Walliams and Nitin Ganatra. Chapter 1. Prawn-Cocktail-Crisp Breath. The hamster was dead. On his back, legs in the air, dead. With tears running down her cheeks, Zoe opened the cage. Her hands were shaking and her heart was breaking. As she laid Ginger Nut's little furry body down on the worn carpet, she thought she would never smile again. "Sheila!" called Zoe, as loudly as she could. Despite her father's repeated pleas, Zoe refused to call her stepmother Mum. She never had, and she vowed to herself that she never would. No one could replace Zoe's mum, not that her stepmother ever even tried.
"Shut your face, I'm watching TV and stuffing myself," came the woman's gruff voice from the lounge.
"It's Ginger Nut," called Zoe. "He's not well." This was an understatement. Zoe had once seen a hospital drama on the telly, where a nurse tried to revive a dying old man. So she desperately attempted to give her hamster mouth-to-mouth resuscitation by blowing very gently into his open mouth. That didn't work. Neither did connecting the rodent's little heart to an AA battery with a paperclip. It was just too late. The hamster was cold to the touch, and he was stiff.
"Sheila, please help!"
shouted the little girl. At first, Zoe's tears came silently, before she let out a gigantic cry. Finally, she heard her stepmother trudge reluctantly down the hall of the little flat, which was situated high up on the 37th floor of a leaning tower block. The woman made huge effort noises whenever she had to do anything. She was so lazy, she would order Zoe to pick her nose for her, though of course Zoe always said no. Sheila could even let out a groan while changing channels with the TV remote.
"Ugh!
Huffed Sheila as she thundered down the hall. Zoe's stepmother was quite short, but she made up for it by being as wide as she was tall. She was, in a word, spherical. Soon Zoe could sense the woman standing in the doorway, blocking out the light from the hall like a lunar eclipse. What's more, Zoe could smell the sickly sweet aroma of prawn cocktail crisps. Her stepmother loved them. In fact, she boasted that from when she was a toddler, she had refused to eat anything else and spat any other food back in her mum's face. Zoe thought the crisps stank, and not even of prawns. Of course, the woman's breath absolutely reeked of them too. Even now, as she stood in the doorway, Zoe's stepmother was holding a packet of the noxious snack with one hand and feeding her face with the other, while she surveyed the scene. As always, she was wearing a long, grubby white t-shirt, black leggings, and furry pink slippers. The bits of skin that were exposed were covered in tattoos. Her arms bore the names of her ex-husbands, all since crossed out. Mick, Steve, Dave, Hamish, Jeff, Amir, Dick, Steve P, Leroy.
"Oh, dear,"
the woman spat, her mouth full of crisps.
Oh, dear, how very, very sad. It's heartbreaking. The poor little thing has snuffed it."
She leaned over her little stepdaughter and peered down at the dead hamster. She sprayed the carpet with half-chewed pieces of crisp as she spoke.
Dear, and all that stuff,"
she added, in a tone that did not sound even remotely sad. Just then, a large piece of half-chewed crisp sprayed from Sheila's mouth onto the poor thing's little fluffy face. It was a mixture of crisp and spit. The technical name for this is a spisp. Zoe wiped it away gently as a tear dropped from her eye onto his cold pink nose.
"Here, I've got a great idea," said Zoe's stepmother. "I'll just finish these crisps, and you can shove the little thing in the bag. I won't touch it myself. I don't want to catch something."
Sheila lifted the bag above her mouth and poured the last of the prawn cocktail crisp crumbles down her greedy throat. The woman then offered her stepdaughter the empty bag.
There you go. Bung in here quick before it stinks the old flat out.
Zoe almost gasped at the unfairness of what the woman had just said. It was her fat stepmother's prawn cocktail crisp breath that stank the place out. Her breath could strip paint. It could shear the feathers off a bird and make it bald. If the wind changed direction, you would get a nasty waft of her breath in a town 10 miles away.
I'm not burying my poor ginger nut in a crisp packet, snapped Zoe. I don't know why I called for you in the first place. Please, just go.
For goodness sake, girl, shouted the woman. I was only trying to help. Ungrateful little wretch.
Well, you're not helping, shouted Zoe, without turning round. Just go away, please.
Sheila thundered out of the room and slammed the door so hard that plaster fell from the ceiling. Zoe listened as the woman she refused to call Mum trudged back to the kitchen, no doubt to rip open another family-sized bag of prawn cocktail crisps to fill her face with. The little girl was left alone in her tiny bedroom, cradling her dead hamster. But how had he died? Zoe knew that Gingernut was very young, even in hamster years. Could this be a hamster murder? She wondered. But what kind of person would want to murder a defenseless little hamster? Well, before this story is over, you will know. And you will also know that there are people capable of doing much, much worse. The most evil man in the world is lurking somewhere in this story. Listen on, if you dare. Chapter 2. A Very Special Little Girl. Before we meet this deeply wicked individual, we need to go back to the beginning. Zoe's real mum died when she was a baby, but Zoe had still had a very happy life. Dad and Zoe had always been a little team, and he showered her with love. While Zoe was at school, Dad went out to work at the local ice cream factory. He had adored ice cream ever since he was a boy and loved working in the factory, even though his job involved long hours, not much money, and very hard work. What kept Zoe's dad going was making brand new ice cream flavors. At the end of every shift at the factory, he would rush home excitedly, laden with samples of some weird and wonderful new flavor for Zoe to be the first to try. Then he would report back what she liked to the boss. These were Zoe's favorites: Sherbet Bang, Bubblicious Bubblegum, Triple Choconut Fudge Swirl, Candy Floss Supreme, Caramel and Custard, Mango Surprise, Cola Cube and Jelly, Peanut Butter and Banana Foam, Pineapple and Licorice, Whiz Fizz Space Dust Explosion. Her least favorite was Snail and Broccoli. Not even Zoe's dad could make snail and broccoli ice cream taste good. Not all of the flavors made it to the shops, especially not snail and broccoli, but Zoe tried them all. Sometimes she ate so much ice cream she thought she would explode. Best of all, she would often be the only child in the world to try them, and that made Zoe feel like a very special little girl indeed. There was one problem. Being an only child, Zoe had no one at home to play with, apart from her dad, who worked long hours at the factory. So by the time she reached the age of 9, like many kids, she wanted a pet with all her heart and soul. It didn't have to be a hamster. She just needed something, anything, to love. Something that she hoped would love her back. However, living on the 37th floor of a leaning tower block, it had to be something small. So, on Zoe's 10th birthday, as a surprise, Dad left work early and met his daughter at the school gates. He carried her on his shoulders. She had always loved that ever since she was a baby, and took her to the local pet shop. There, he bought her a hamster. Zoe picked out the fluffiest, cutest baby one and named him Gingernut. Gingernut lived in a cage in the little girl's bedroom. Zoe didn't mind that Gingernut would go round and round on his wheel at night, keeping her awake. She didn't mind that he nipped her finger a couple of times when she fed him biscuits as a special treat. She even didn't mind that his cage smelled of hamster wee. In short, Zoe loved Gingernut, and Gingernut loved Zoe. Zoe didn't have many friends at school. What's more, the other kids bullied her for being short and ginger and having to wear braces on her teeth. Just one of those things would have been enough for her to have a hard time. She had hit the jackpot with all three. Gingernut was small and ginger too, though of course he didn't wear braces. That smallness and gingerness was probably, deep down, why Zoe chose him out of the dozens of little balls of fluff snuggled up together behind the glass at the pet shop. She must have sensed a kindred spirit. Over the weeks and months that followed, Zoe taught Gingernut some mind-boggling tricks. For a sunflower seed, he would stand on his back legs and do a little dance. For a walnut, Gingernut would do a backflip. And for a lump of sugar, he would spin around on his back. Zoe's dream was to make her little pet world famous as the very first breakdancing hamster. She planned to put on a little show at Christmas for all the other children on the estate. She even made a poster to advertise it. It read, "Gingernut, that breakdancing hamster. He locks, he floor rocks, he up rocks, he does the robot. He's learning the windmill, but can't quite do it yet. On the decks, Zoe." Then one day, Dad came home from work with some very sad news, which would tear their happy little life apart. Chapter 3. Nuffink.
"I lost my job," said Dad.
"No," said Zoe.
"They're shutting down a factory, moving the whole operation to China."
"But you will find another job, won't you?"
"I will try," said Dad, "but it won't be easy. There'll be loads of us all looking for the same ones." As it turned out, it wasn't easy. It was, in fact, impossible. With so many people losing their jobs all at once, Dad was forced to claim benefit money from the government. It was a pittance, barely enough to live on. With nothing to do all day, Dad became more and more down. To begin with, he went to the job centre every day. But there were never any jobs within 100 miles, and eventually he started going to the pub instead. Zoe could tell because she was fairly sure that job centres didn't stay open till late at night. Zoe became more and more worried about her father. Sometimes she wondered if he had given up on life altogether. Losing first his wife and then his job seemed like just too much for him to bear. Little did he know, things were about to get much, much worse. Dad met Zoe's stepmother when he was at his saddest. He was lonely, and she was on her own, her last husband having died in a mysterious prawn-cocktail-crisp-related incident. Sheila seemed to think that husband number 10's benefit money would provide her with an easy life, with fags on tap and all the prawn-cocktail-crisps she could eat. As Zoe's real mum had died when Zoe was a baby, as much as she tried, and she tried and tried, Zoe could not remember her. There used to be photographs of Mum up all over the flat. Mum had a kind smile. Zoe would stare at the photographs and try and smile just like her. They certainly looked alike, especially when they were smiling. However, one day when everyone was out, Zoe's new stepmother took all the photographs down. Now they were conveniently lost, probably burnt. Dad didn't like talking about Mum because it would just make him cry. However, she lived on in Zoe's heart. The little girl knew that her real Mum had loved her very much. She just knew it.
Zoe also knew her stepmother did not love her, or even like her very much. In truth, Zoe was pretty sure her stepmother hated her. Sheila treated her at worst as an irritant, at best as if she was invisible.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.